Greetings to you, my brothers and sisters in Christ. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. I bring you greetings here from Friendship Baptist Church. On behalf of our pastor, Dr. Reginald Backus, our Sunday School Superintendent, Sister Fredra Williams, all of the officers and members of this great church, we're just blessed that you have continued to support us and work with us as we continue to share our Sunday School lessons through our social media pages, Facebook and YouTube. Today's lesson is entitled Family Restored. It's taken from the 19th chapter of Revelation, verses 1 through 8. And it talks about the celebration of all of creation, those that have believed in God and given their lives to God, and how at the culmination of this plan of God saving the entire world, that we are all gathered around his throne and celebrate together. We've been in the book of Revelation for 3 weeks now, and we've been kind of following John and his visions that God gave him. And it's just a refresher to kind of see that all that we go through and all that we're dealing with here on earth throughout our lives, that one day there will be no more sickness, no more pain, no more disease, no more war. And those of us that believe in Christ will be called to glory, where we can celebrate and dwell in his presence forever. Our key verse this morning is taken from the 19th chapter of Revelation, verse 7, and it reads, "Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready." In today's lesson, we're going to try to do three things. First, we'll examine the effect of God's judgment in the lives of believers. Secondly, we will recognize that the justice and mercy of God is revealed in his judgment. And then third, we will commit to living towards and eventually dwelling in the eternal love of God. And we will look forward to the day where we can rest in the presence of God forevermore. And so what a wonderful lesson. Again, we've been in Revelation for 3 weeks, just kind of celebrating and looking at the victory that God will eventually have over the enemy, and that God's eternal reign not only is promised, but is guaranteed in the life of each believer. If you stumbled upon this channel or this lesson for the first time, make sure you subscribe to the channel and turn your notifications on our church pages. We are sharing evening Bible classes each Wednesday night, our live Sunday worship on Sunday at 11, and our Sunday School lessons. And on my channel, we're just putting out Sunday School lessons each week. So it's a wonderful opportunity to follow Friendship and our pastor, Dr. Backus, as we continue to use the best resources we have to share God's word in this time of this COVID pandemic. Also, this is the Thanksgiving week. And so as we prepare for Thanksgiving on Thursday, we have so much to be thankful for, not only in all of our lives personally, no matter how difficult or challenging times might be, God still woke us up and he still keeps us in our right mind. And so we just want to be thankful that even though we may not necessarily have all that we want, God has given us all that we need, and so we praise God for that. And so happy Thanksgiving to each and every one of you. I pray that you all have a safe holiday, that you be as safe as possible with mincing and traveling with family through this COVID pandemic, and that we continue to be safe. Don't eat too much, and I hope the Bears, the Chicago Bears, win. Let's jump right into our lesson, and we'll begin with prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for another opportunity to share in your word. Father, we thank you for all the blessings that you give us day by day. Father, we recognize that we have stumbled and fallen short, but we thank you for brand new graces and brand new mercies as you continue to forgive us and look into us and pour into us and give us blessings that we do not deserve, but according to your love for us that you still so richly supply. Thank you for our pastor, Dr. Backus, our Sunday School Superintendent, Sister Fredra Williams, all of our instructors, all of our students, all of the members of this church, and anyone that might have stumbled upon this lesson. We just pray that we be lifted up higher and see you clear and be better equipped for your will in our lives. These and other prayers we ask in your son Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And just before we go right into the lesson, I just want to remind everyone that if you're a member of Friendship Baptist Church, all of our classes are continuing to meet either through conference call or Zoom. So please reach out to your instructor or give us a call here at the church, and we make sure that we'll get you the correct information. So we're still in Revelation, and I don't want to spend too much time on the introduction. There's a few things that we've covered extensively 2 weeks ago, and then we kind of referenced or reviewed last week, if you will. And so I don't want to spend too much time, but we know that John, he was the apostle. Pretty much he was placed over the Asia Minor region, or he took over like the Asia churches, kind of like in the northeast area from where the gospel accounts happened. And John was marooned or quarantined, however you want to put it, on an island called Patmos. And while he was on this island, God gave him a vision and asked him to write it down. It was a vision of the end times. And so when we talk about end time prophecy, the proper term is called eschatology. Eschatology. And we talk about the God's plan for the salvation of the world. Now, as a Baptist church, we are premillennial dispensationalists, which means that we believe that God's plan for salvation happens in stages over time, beginning with creation, and then the fall of man, then the promise to Abraham, then the intertestamental period, then the church age. And we're in the church age now. And then we also believe that the next stage will be the tribulation, or the second coming of Christ, which kicks off the tribulation, which is the thousand-year reign of the enemy, of the evil one on earth. And so this lesson today picks up at the end of the tribulation. Once Babylon is defeated, the enemy is destroyed, and all of creation now gather around the throne of God to celebrate and worship him. And by all of creation, I mean those that believe, because those that did not believe were already cast out, cast into the bottomless pit and for eternal damnation. And so John wrote this letter to the seven churches in Asia. It's kind of not only as a warning, but as an encouragement that even though life is difficult and challenging, we must stay true to the promise of God and recognize that one day, eventually, we'll be free from all this pain and suffering. Now, this letter was written some 2,000 years ago. If we want to get specific, we would say like 1950 years ago, somewhere in there, between like 56 and 67 AD, 51 and 67 AD. And so we're talking about a 1,950-year-old letter that's reminding the believers that eventually Christ will return. And now, some 2,000 years later, we're still looking forward to this promise of the return of Christ. But the Bible makes it clear that no man knows the day nor the hour in which Christ returns. And so our job, our responsibility as Christians is to not only make sure that we're prepared by giving our life to Christ and living a life of righteousness, but also by sharing the gospel, living a life that reflects the love of Christ to others, by sharing the gospel as often and as much as we can so that others, our friends, our loved ones, our family members, our husbands, our children, our parents, our coworkers, our neighbors, the people we sit by on the bus, the young man or young woman at the grocery store, so that all of creation can experience the same love of God that has changed and transformed our lives. And so the letter still rings true today. Not only is it a reminder of God's promise and the eventual overcoming of the world and the defeat of the enemy, but it's also an encouragement that lets us know that no matter how much we feel as if we're struggling right now, that God has something in store for us. So our lesson is broken down into three different parts, and these aren't very long lessons, but we'll make sure that we take our time to go through it. Taken from the 19th chapter of Revelation, I'll be reading from the New King James Version. But the first part of our lesson is entitled The Voices of Praise and Celebration. The text reads, Revelation 19, 1 through 4. After these things, I heard a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, Alleluia, salvation and glory and honor and power belong to the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments, because he has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth with her fornication, and he has avenged on her the blood of his servants shed by her. Again they said, Hallelujah. Her smoke rises up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God who sat on the throne, saying, Amen, Hallelujah. So John begins chapter 19, following the destruction of Babylon and the defeat of the beasts, of the enemy, of the evil one. Now all of creation that remains, including all the believers, the angels, the 24 elders, the beasts that are gathered around this throne, they're worshiping God in a response and in gratitude towards the work that God has just done towards defeating the enemy. So after centuries for some and years for others, all followers of Christ, both that have passed on before, both that are alive right now, and both that we'll be born after we may pass away if Christ does not return in our lifetime. All believers are gathered around the throne of God, all angels, all these elders, and they're worshiping God in a spirit of gratitude and victory because of the work that God has done. So these people have been given three things, in my opinion. They've been given assurance. They've been given dedication, and they've been given glorification. So the assurance was that the promises that they've held onto their entire lives has now come to fruition. The dedication was them dedicating their now eternal futures towards worshiping God, because we are free from having to worry about anything else. And then the glorification process has now been completed in their lives. Once we believe in God, we are justified, meaning found not guilty through the work of Jesus Christ. And then the lives that we live is the sanctification process. That is the cleansing process of God making us whole, of taking us from filthy to clean, making us not right with God to right with God. And then the glorification process, it's when we're lifted up and freed from the bondage of sin and the chains of this world, and we're presented faultless before God's presence. And now this glorification process finally takes hold in the life of the believer, and we are before God's throne, free from the pain and the sins of the world, but as perfect and as white as snow. So when John, he sees this group there, now he hears a loud voice of all the peoples, almost speaking in unison. And for the last 3 weeks, we've examined what's happened around this throne. And there's a group of people around. We had 144,000. That was the first number that John saw. Then we got the 24 elders. We have the four beasts, or the four creatures, as it says in this text today. And then there's a number that's too great to be counted. Now, others hypothesize and they assume who could be represented in these numbers, then the 24 elders, who's gathered around the throne. Some people say it's the elders of the faith. Some people say it's the martyrs, those that have died for the cause of Christ. Some say it's the leaders of the 12 tribes of Israel. Some say it represents the 12 disciples and the 12 tribes, which makes up 24. Some say that it's representatives of both Jews and Gentiles throughout history, or great men of God throughout the ages that have suffered for the sake of Christ. And then some even say that it's angels and heavenly beings. Regardless who's up there, we know, or who's speaking, or who's being counted and represented, the Bible makes it clear that all of creation, that means every single person, has now been freed from this world and now dwells freely before the Lord. And so they cry out, hallelujah, and then they give God, they worship God for what I counted is four things. The first thing is salvation. So they say hallelujah to God for salvation because God has now revealed himself as the true savior of all mankind through the work of Jesus Christ. So the salvation that believers receive can only be accomplished through the work of Christ by being obedient to his Father who sent him to die for the sins of the world. So they cry out hallelujah for salvation. Then they cry out hallelujah for glory. Here we see God lifted up above and before all creation as the true king. He's exalted, which means there's literally no more doubt. There's no more fear. There's no more worry. Those that have believed, we now find our confirmation. And those that did not believe are forced to accept the eternal mistake that they've made in their life by rejecting the gift of Christ. And then they cry hallelujah for salvation, for glory, and then also for honor, because God is worthy of the honor and worthy of the praise. So often in life, we find reasons not to honor someone. In the last 5 years over the course of our country through political discourse, there's been so much hatred towards our commander in chief. Going back to our previous president, where people would refuse to go to a State of the Union address, and now our current president, where people are signing bills in cities named Brandon just to make a vulgar, disrespectful declaration towards the president. I remember a time where respect and honor was given just because someone was your elder, just because someone held the title. And now, even Christians, we've grown to a place where we are finding reasons to be not just show a lack of respect, but to be disrespectful towards other people who we would never disrespect before. Grew up in a time where every elder deserved respect, regardless if they were a stranger or not, or all police officers, all teachers, all judges. And now, because of this political climate that we live in, it's just so much animosity and hatred that just rampantly spreads throughout our society. But here in this picture in Revelation 19, they're crying out hallelujah, because if there's one person in all of creation that deserves the respect, that deserves the honor, that has never failed, that has never lied, that's always been true to his word, is God. And so now God is lifted up as the one person who deserves honor. Think of all the people we stand up for. We stand up for flags, for anthems. We stand up in respect for people of power and authority. But now they're worshiping God because he is truly worthy to be honored. And so we see him say hallelujah for salvation, for glory, for honor. And then finally, the fourth thing is for power. God did what no one else was able to do. He saved us. He died for us. He preserved us. He defeated the enemy. And now he reigns for all of eternity. And so God, through his promise, through the work of Christ, and through the defeat of the enemy, we're pulled from the chains of this world. And then he preserves us. He protects us while we're in this world. And then he defeats those that stand against him, and then reigns for all of eternity with no more challenges. So God is, they scream hallelujah for these four things. And then God is also recognized in their worship. They recognize him for his great judgment, because God's judgment is both true and it's righteous. The text makes it clear. The righteousness of God's judgment means that God has never had a bad verdict, that he's never been biased on the throne, that he's always above reproach, and that subsequently makes him the only one equipped to be judged. We have so much access now to court. I remember when I was in probably my first year in high school during the O.J. Simpson trial, and it seems like every day we were watching these trials on television, and I remember the attorneys, I remember OJ trying on the glove, but for some reason, I don't really remember the judge so much. And then this last trial that we've just been captivated with as a nation, the Kyle Rittenhouse trial in Wisconsin, we've seen the judge trying to become the center of the spectacle, if you will, doing some things that people agree with and some things others did not. But the response has been that you share, or you use your voting power to relay your feelings about the judge. So if you don't think that he's equipped to judge or he was unfair, then you can relay that feeling, that sentiment at the voting box. In a world today where the judicial system literally has the power to decide our future and our lives, with so many issues being before our Supreme Court right now, from issues with Second Amendment rights and firearm to issues with women's rights and choices they have over their bodies in reference to abortion, to issues with affirmative action, to issues with voting rights. These are four of the major topics that are before our Supreme Court as we speak. And we have nine people that are going to make a decision that's going to affect not only our lives, but our children and our generations to come. And so we find so many times where people are either ill-equipped, or they're biased, or they're the wrong person for the job when making these judgment calls. But here we see God as the judge of all of creation, and we see his righteousness and his truth reveals itself in his judgment. The truth is that God has promised us that if we accept his son Jesus as our Savior, then we shall be saved. It's not of our own volition or our own deeds. It's through the work of Christ that we accept. And then through that acceptance, we try to be more like Christ in our living, which gives us our own sense of righteousness as we move towards Christ and away from the world. God does not play favorites. God does not look and say, well, she sings better than he sings, or he preaches better than she preaches, or he has better attendance than she has attendance. God looks past our faults and past our shortcomings and sees us only through the work of Christ, covered by his blood, And then therefore the truth and righteousness in his judgment is revealed in our own lives because we recognize that we're fallible, we've fallen, we've made mistakes, but still, yet and still, God has saw fit to look past those faults and forgive us and give us eternal life through the work of Christ. So God is recognizing their worship for his great judgment. But then God is also praised for the way that he deals with the enemy. The enemy or sin, the devil, the beast, or however you want to look at it, is in this verse described as a harlot, a prostitute. And John makes it clear that she persuaded God's creation to turn away from God and turn towards their own worldly desires. So not only does God defend those that have been hurt by this harlot, by sin, by the evil one, but God avenges those that were harmed by sin. It talks about how those that whose blood was shed, they are now avenged. They are now made whole. They are now compensated for the evil that was done towards them by the enemy. And so a lot of times in life, we go through looking at the harm that good people find themselves in and looking at the seemingly ability to escape punishment or wrath or even be acknowledged as wrongdoing for those that operate against the will of God. Where the Bible makes it clear, the battle is not ours, but the Lord's. And the Bible also makes it clear, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Well, here in this 19th chapter of John, we see the people of God, those that are believers, worshiping and praising God because now the vengeance that God has promised is taking place and we are no longer victims, but we are overcomers of the world. Many a times in life, it's really easy to stumble into bouts of despair or depression when we believe that righteous, those that seek to do righteous before God continue to be hurt while evildoers just get away scot-free. And we see it in so many forms, in inequality, injustice, racism, unfair systems, what seems as if it's two different systems of justice. But John shows us in verse 3 that he hears this multitude celebrating because the enemy is defeated, and not just defeated, but forevermore, eternally defeated. The constant rising of the smoke, it signifies this eternal damnation that those who oppose God are forced to endure. Because the smoke continues to rise, that means the fire continues to burn. And that means that those that are tormented by the fire continue to feel the pain. And so for years, for thousands of years, we've seen those that have given their lives for the sake of Christ, that have suffered for Christ's sake. Now they're not only vindicated, but they're exalted and lifted up. And then they're able to see the enemies of God finally get their just desserts, if you will. So verse 4 concludes with the elders and the beasts around the throne falling down and humbly worshiping God. For almost 3 months now, I would say, going back to when David was pulling the Ark of the Covenant and bringing it back into Jerusalem, we've seen how the testimony of God's people, of his followers, have influenced their own worship and praise towards God and pushed them into a deeper worship and deeper praise. Here in the text, it's as if the voices of those gathered around the throne not only makes a declaration to all of creation, but it kind of persuades and convinces them, and it pushes them into a worship that it almost seems unexpected because they go from speaking and declaring to worshiping and praising, falling down before the throne of God. At church, a lot of times in worship services or celebratory services, even in celebrations of life and funerals, when people stand up to share stories about their loved ones or give personal testimonies about the impact that others had on their lives, they tend to get choked up and sometimes overwhelmed. This happens because as they think and as they speak, they become consumed by their own words. They're not only reminded, but they're convinced of the impact. Sometimes they're reminding themselves, not just others, of how important or how impactful that person was in their life. Now, this reveals itself the same way when we talk about others. It should reveal itself in the life of the Christian when we talk about Jesus Christ. When we talk about what God has done, what he is doing, what he will continue to do in our lives, it's impossible to share that information with others to testify what God is doing around us and in us and through us without being consumed by the work and the work revealing itself in our praise and worship. And so these first four verses, John sees these group of people around the throne, the voice crying out, not only declaring and testifying, but now being consumed by their own testimony and declaration and falling into a deep worship of God. So before we move on to the second point, it's just something about the word of God. It's something about sharing what God has done and is doing in our lives that not only convinces others, but it almost reminds us. It's like going through a picture book and you start to think of some of those memories that you forgot. And when you start thinking about the details and the backstory of each picture, the picture means so much more. And all of us in our own lives have so many stories and can share so many things about what God has and is doing. And then when we really think about it, it's like, whoa, I kind of forgot exactly the details and the backstory. And it makes the work of Christ even that more and worthy of praise. So the first part of our lesson, we see the voices of praise and celebration. That's Revelation 19, 1 through 4. The second part of our lesson, we see the call to worship. And that's coming from Revelation 19, verses 5 and 6. It says, then a voice came from the throne saying, praise our God, all you his servants and those who fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. So now John hears a voice coming from the throne. Now, even though the speaker is not identified, we assume that it's maybe one of the 24 elders or some of the angels and heavenly creatures that are around the throne. But their audience are all those that are alive. Now, based on our religious approach to this tribulation, this group might differ. We talked about it 2 weeks extensively, and I encourage you to go back and look at that. I don't really want to really break it down fully because it might take a little more time than we have. But pre-tribulation means that we are before the tribulation. Let me stop. There are three different systems of belief, pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib. Some believe that we are in the midst of the rapture now. We're mid-trib. Some people believe the rapture already happened and we're post-trib. The general Baptist belief is that we're pre-trib, meaning that we're waiting for the second coming of Christ, that when we're raptured up at his return, the tribulation will occur. And so depending on where you fall in there, some people think that they're speaking to all the creation. Some people think that they're speaking to those that were not initially raptured up, but they did not give into the mark of the beast and will be saved through the tribulation or after the tribulation. But regardless of what group you believe it is, we do know that they are servants of God that have endured and now are lifted up and exalted before the Lord as victories over death and over the world. And so when we look into this phrase, servant of God, it's really the responsibility and the goal of every Christian to be called a servant of God. As a matter of fact, in Matthew 25, in the parable, Jesus talks about that one day that we want to hear those words, well done, my good and my faithful servant. And so that's what the Christian is really building towards, that we can live a life of servitude towards God so that one day we can be rewarded for our service for him. The voice instructs the hearer to both recognize that God reigns above all of the earth and all of the opposition against God has been dealt with. So there is no longer any doubt that God is the true king, that God reigns forever. There is no more challenge to the power and the authority of God. God has become victorious over the world. And now the voice from the throne instructs us to celebrate the victory that we've achieved through the work of God. Now, during the early years of Christianity, when this letter was written, again, first century AD, there were many false teachings and challenges of the Greeks and the Romans. They spent almost unlimited resources trying to squash or quell the growth of Christianity for several reasons. One, it was a challenge to their own cultural and governmental systems. Secondly, Old Testament Jewish influencers would appeal towards the government, thinking that it would cause up a rebellion and an opposition. there was still some thought that the king of the Jews would come to overthrow the Roman occupation, and they would have to fight a political or even a military battle through this Christian movement. So there were so many things that were going on. Not to mention, as I said before, the false teachers and the challenges that they endured, people misinterpreting the scripture, people not giving themselves to study and being able to share the word accurately, people not comfortable with the sufficiency of the gospel story, thinking that there must be something more to it. It simply can't be as easy as accepting Jesus Christ as their savior. And so there were so many issues. And so the Christian, we are called to humble ourselves and to sacrifice. And that means that we have to deal with false teachings. We have to deal with oppression. We have to deal with people that want to attack just for the sake of attacking. Now, from a 21st century Western perspective, Christians in America have it pretty easy, comparatively speaking. Even compared to other places in this world where Christians are not free to congregate and gather and worship as they see fit. And then when we look historically, our access to resources, our ability to pray on our own, our ability to read scripture on our own, all of these things did not exist at some point in time throughout history. And so we must look beyond our own comfortability in our worship and our religious practice and recognize the challenges that the recipients of this letter was facing. But John made it clear. He said, here, the voice from the throne vindicates the believer who suffered for the sake of Christ, and it rewards them by giving them the opportunity, the gift to dwell in the presence of God throughout all of eternity and to give all of their effort in praising and worshiping God throughout that same eternity. So the spirit in which we move and the spirit in which we operate, it must be based in an admiration and a respect towards God. And here that admiration and respect is confirmed, and we are no longer bound by the pains that we had previously in this world. We are now free to just dwell with God, free of the bondage of this world. So now all of creation is able to celebrate in the unity of victory over the enemy, and we find a confirmation of our eternal salvation and our eternal glorification. So basically, the second part of our lesson just shows that we are instructed to celebrate that God has given us victory and we are no longer bound, but we are rewarded for being servants. The truth is that God did not promise us that we would be free from pain in this world. He just promised us that he would preserve us and keep us, and that one day we will be lifted up above it. And so here in verse 5 and 6, we celebrate that exaltation and lifting up of the believer above the sins of this world. So we start off in verses 1 through 4 with the voices of praise and celebration. Then we move to verse 5 and 6 with the call to worship. But now we go to Revelation chapter 19, verse 7 and 8, the marriage of the Lamb. The text reads, "Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints." So we conclude our lesson with this imagery of marriage that John uses to illustrate the relationship between God and the church. The marriage of the Lamb, it shows that the promised eternal salvation and glorification of believers is now taking place. For thousands of years, since the days of Abraham, when God promised to one day save his chosen people and defeat those that stands against him, now we see all of creation celebrating together as one the date that has been hoped for and lit towards since the beginning of Christianity. The bride, which is the church, appears in fine linen, clean and white. It represents the work of Christ on the cross, how when he shed his blood, we were washed white as snow, and it allows the believers to be presented faultless before God's presence. It's really my favorite benediction. It's in the last two verses of Jude, the book right before Revelation, the second to last book in the Bible. It says, "Now unto him who's able to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding great joy, To the only wise God, our Father, be both glory and majesty, but have dominion and power, both now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen. It talks about how the work of Christ on the cross is literally the only way that we're able to stand before God faultless, which goes back to our first part of our lesson, the judgment of God being righteous and true. The reason why he's able to judge us and find us not guilty, and we gain access to eternal life and access to the presence of the Lord, is because when Christ gave his life and paid the debt for our sin, we were now washed whole and made new, meaning we are no longer bound by this world. God, being perfect and good, is not able to dwell with imperfect and bad or sin. And on our own, our sins prevent us from having access to God through Christ. But we thank God today that we're not on our own. And that's how we'll end this lesson, with a spirit of thankfulness. It's so fitting, being Thanksgiving week, that we can be thankful that we're not on our own. It's not up to us to save ourselves. But because of the work that Christ did on the cross, he died that we might have eternal life. And it was his sacrifice that presents us before God worthy of that gift of eternal life. It's the blood of Christ that washes us white as snow and enables believers to escape the pains of this world and dwell in the presence of the Lord forever. Amen. Again, like I said, it's not a long lesson, but such a great lesson. For many of us, we struggle with the challenges of this world. For many of us, we struggle knowing that we're trying our best to live a life pleasing in the sight of the Lord. And it seems as if our struggles continue to mount, where those that are just recklessly living against God's word continue to flourish. Here we see not only the celebration of all believers unified by our one common theme, salvation in Christ, dwelling in the presence of the Lord and celebrating and worshiping him, but we also see the smoke rising up, showing that the enemy is defeated and we no longer have to worry or deal with the challenges that it brought. And then finally, we fall down and celebrate God because his son's sacrifice, Jesus's work on the cross, presents us faultless, perfect before God's presence. And now we have access to eternal life. The good news is, regardless religiously or theologically, or better said, where you stand on like this pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, John Calvin said it best. All that matters is a man named Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died on the cross for our sins and got up out the grave. If you believe that, and I know for a fact I believe it, but if we believe it together, then one day, I don't know the day or the hour, but one day, and hopefully soon and very soon, we will be free from this world. We will be in the presence of the Lord, and we will be able to dwell free from sin, free from pain, free from sickness, free from disease, free from racism, free from distress, free from depression, free from sickness, free from famine, free from starvation, free from crime, free from violence, and free from war. And we'll stand in God's presence and dwell amongst all of creation, celebrating his glory and worshiping him for what he is worthy of. And that's worthy to be king, worthy to be Lord, worthy to be lifted up and exalted above all. This is a great lesson. I'm really encouraged today. I praise God for all that he is doing and all that he will continue to do in our lives. And I anxiously look forward to the day where we can celebrate all that he is doing in our lives. I just want to thank you for joining us again. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your support. There are so many ways to support us here at Friendship. Each Tuesday morning at 8 a.m., we have a prayer call led by our senior associate, Reverend Aaron Davidson. The phone number is 978-990-5064. And the access code is 283-8954. But we encourage you to join us in prayer as we continue to call out the names of our entire sick and shut-in list and ask for God's favor, not only in this church and on our congregation, but for all of creation. Each Wednesday evening at 6 p.m., we have a Bible class. We're currently going through the book of Romans, led by our pastor, Dr. Back. He's a wonderful instructor, wonderful lessons, and we encourage you. You can even catch up. We're only through chapter 3 right now, so it's about 4 or 5 lessons. You can catch up and pick right back up with us. We also have this Wednesday specifically at 7 p.m. is our Thanksgiving virtual service, and that information will be on our Facebook page. So please join us on Zoom as we show God how thankful we are for his continued blessings in our life. And then our Sunday, each Sunday morning at 11 a.m. is our live worship service, where you'll hear some of the best preaching this side of heaven. This upcoming Sunday, today is our youth service. So we had to kind of do an abbreviated service. You know, there's so many restrictions with COVID, but our praise dancers are leading us in worship. And so we're just excited to celebrate our young people, continue to pray for our young people, not only in this church, but across the land. And then you can support us through your donations and through your giving. We do have 4 ways to give here at the church. You can give on Cash App, $FriendshipChicago. You can give online, fbcchicago.org. You can text the word give to 773-992-1462, or you can mail your check or money order to the church. Friendship Baptist Church, care of Pastor Reginald E. Backus, 5200 West Jackson Boulevard, Chicago, Illinois, 60644. Praise God for all of you all that have given and supported this ministry. And if by chance you're looking to support a ministry, what better place to sow a seed in fertile ground? And here at Friendship, we're doing some amazing things, some amazing work. And we just would love for you to partner with us as we continue to do the will of God, not only in our community and in our congregation, but everywhere where God leads us. Let's keep our pastor in our prayers, Dr. Backus. He's celebrating his father's 50th anniversary. His father, Pastor C.L. Backus, is the pastor of Mount Zion Baptist Church in Kansas City, Kansas. And so the entire family, Backus family, is there celebrating 50 years of pastoring at Mount Zion. So let's continue to pray for them, celebrate Dr. Backus, Dr. C.L. Backus, and pray for their safe travel home. If nothing else, thank you again for your time. Please make sure you're subscribed to the channel, you have your notifications turned on, and God willing, we will see you next week. And then hopefully we'll see you in just a few moments for our 11 a.m. worship. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for this lesson and all that's been said and done. Father, continue to let your will and your purpose reign in our lives. Forgive us of any sins that we commit and equip us to be better examples of your love and your light. And as we go around the world, others might see our good works, but give you glory. And they come running asking, what must they do to be saved? And we'll be ever so careful to point them in the direction of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave his life so that we can be presented faultless before your throne. Father, we have a reason to be thankful. You've protected us and kept us and saved us. And so with a clean and our true heart, we just call out, thank you for blessing us. Thank you for keeping us. And may your spirit continue to dwell in this place. It is in your Son, Jesus Christ's name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Have a blessed week, and we'll see you at 11 a.m. for our worship service.